Hello, class. Welcome to this lecture, Introduction to Africana Aesthetics, Cornel West, Hip Hop Wars, and Afrofuturism. Like with our unit on Chicanx Aesthetics and Gloria Anzaldúa, this course has arrived finally at the late 20th and early 21st centuries, so let's talk a little bit about aesthetics in black. A few epigraph quotations for this lecture from Ralph Ellison, quote, "I am an invisible man. I am a man of substance, of flesh and bone, fibers and liquids. I might even be said to possess a mind. I am invisible, understand, simply because people refuse to see me." Ta-Nehisi Coates writes that white supremacy is not merely the work of hot-headed demagogues or a matter of false consciousness, but a force so fundamental to America that it is difficult to imagine the country without it, and so we must imagine a new country. And also from Greg Tate's, "Black futurism should be observant about race and power relations in this historical moment." Why a unit on aesthetics in black? Well, because people of color, as expressed in the Ralph Ellison quote above, do not always have the, quote, privilege of interpreting themselves in terms of white Eurocentric notions of aesthetic value or self-creation. Their very blackness has historically mediated or barred access to various parts of the Western tradition, including Western aesthetics. Central to black aesthetics is the aim of raising consciousness, of awakening people of color and all people to the persistence of structural racism, exploitation, and oppression, and to the ways in which these conditions strip away black, indigenous, and people of color's capacity for agency and for creativity. The Black Arts Movement was an African-led art movement active during the 1960s and 70s. Through activism in art, BAM created new cultural institutions that conveyed a message of black pride. This lecture will not be covering the whole history of the Black Arts Movement or its speculative futures. What we will do is begin from Cornel West's seminal 1990 article, The New Cultural Politics of Difference, and from there move to a brief overview of Tricia Rose on the emergence and history of hip-hop, and Yetisha Womack on Afrofuturism. So let's introduce Sacramento's very own Cornel West, whose work is extensive, though ever articulating, how economic forces of late capitalism complicate dehumanizing situations and reinforce the hopelessness, rage, and self-loathing that are so pervasive in poor black communities. The result is what West calls a kind of waking nihilism. For West, the nihilism of the black underclass is in large part a byproduct of the global marketplace. And here, the history of aesthetics, the philosophy of art, and its new manifestations in continental aesthetics, such as postmodernism, up until the present, reaches its political limits. As West puts this, those who are most oppressed and exploited are not present, and if they were, they could not possibly understand what is being said. Most importantly, the intellectual focus of postmodernism, so-called, is largely on otherness as a theoretical abstraction. As Lewis Gordon introduces West, there are, in addition, contemporary voices with field-transcending influence. Cornel West and bell hooks, for instance, are two Africana thinkers with extraordinary influence in the contemporary U.S. Academy. West's and Hooks' writings are rooted squarely in Africana humanistic traditions, and West in the 1980s, as is well known, had taken up identity and teleological questions through an effort to syncretize pragmatism, Christianity, and Marxism with African-American humanism to present a prophetic appeal to deliverance, emancipation. West's essay speaks for itself, so introducing it, I'll just be pulling out several of its key citations and first reading and then discussing some of them. West begins the essay, "In the last few years of the 20th century, there is emerging a significant shift in the sensibilities and outlooks of critics and artists. In fact, I would go so far as to claim that a new kind of cultural worker is in the making, associated with a new politics of difference. These new forms of intellectual consciousness advance new conceptions of the vocation of the critic and artist. Attempting to undermine the prevailing disciplinary divisions of labor in the academy, the museum, mass media, and gallery networks, while preserving modes of critique within the ubiquitous commodification of culture in the global village. The new cultural politics of difference are neither simply oppositional in contesting the mainstream or maelstrom for inclusion, nor transgressive in the avant-gardist sense of shocking conventional bourgeois audiences. Rather, they are distinct articulations of talented and usually privileged contributors to culture who desire to align themselves with demoralized, demobilized, depoliticized, and disorganized people in order to empower and enable social action, and if possible, to enlist collective insurgency for the expansion of freedom, democracy, and individuality. This perspective impels these cultural critics and artists to reveal, as an integral component of their production, the very operations of power within their immediate work contexts, academy, museum, gallery, or mass media. The question for West at the outset of this article is how radical artists of color can help to overhaul existing institutions while at the same time being financially dependent on them in a predominantly white art patronage system. He argues that artistic breakthroughs and social progress are only possible through crises in civilization, which are always messy and whose outcome is never certain. Distinctive features of the new cultural politics of difference are to trash the monolithic and homogeneous in the name of diversity, multiplicity, and heterogeneity, to reject the abstract, general, and universal in light of the concrete, the specific, and the particular, and to historicize, contextualize, and pluralize by highlighting the contingent, provisional, variable, tentative, shifting, and the changing. Needless to say, these gestures are not new in the history of criticism or art, yet what makes them novel, along with the cultural politics they produce, is how and what constitutes difference, the weight and the gravity it is given in representation, and the way in which highlighting issues like exterminism, empire, class, race, gender, sexual orientation, age, nation, nature, and region at this historical moment acknowledges some discontinuity and disruption from previous forms of cultural critique. To put it bluntly, the new cultural politics of difference consists of creative responses to the precise circumstances of our present moment. West goes into great detail on what he considers the three big challenges to the new cultural politics of difference. These challenges are the intellectual, the existential, and the political, and he sums them up as so. The intellectual challenge, usually cast as a methodological debate in these days in which academicist forms of expression have a monopoly on intellectual life, is how to think about representational practices in terms of history, culture, and society. The existential challenge to the new cultural politics of difference can be stated simply: how does one acquire the resources to survive and the cultural capital to thrive as a critic or artist? This challenge holds for all prophetic critics. We'll hear more about what prophetic means for West in a moment, yet it is especially difficult for those of color. For West, adequate rejoinders to intellectual and existential challenges equip the practitioners of the new cultural politics to meet the political challenges. This challenge principally consists of forging solid and reliable alliances of people of color and white progressives guided by a moral and political vision of greater democracy and individual freedom in communities, states, and transnational enterprises, i.e. in corporations and information and communication conglomerates. So let's look into West's three challenges in a bit more detail now, starting with the intellectual challenge. The breadth and depth of West's own intellectual perspective is on display here when he begins this section with the ambiguous legacy of the Age of Europe, 1492 to 1945, and proceeds to give us a synoptic review of the modern humanities and its political history. He looks first to Matthew Arnold as British imperialism's exemplary cultural critic, who, like Edmund Burke, studied earlier in this course, advocated for cautious reform for fear of anarchy. Religion and the old aristocracy were no longer the universal social glue, and Arnold clearly foresaw a democratic future, attempting to tie it to secular humanistic values of emerging bourgeois civil society. The dangers for Arnold were the vulgar philistinism of the emerging middle class, and especially the explosiveness of the working class majority. Arnold's question, how to preserve European culture in its sweetness and light, in the midst of these developments of A, massification, and B, democratization. Arnold's answer was critical discourse and a reform of educational institutions, a return to Pericles' Athens, to Imperial Rome, and to Elizabethan England. What this amounted to was a homogenizing of public discourse and espousal of universal humanist ideals. According to West, World War I exposed that safety was not in fact to be found in the progressivism of nation-states. Rather, the state itself was the most dangerous monster of all. In the wake of World War I and upon the ashes of the wasteland of human carnage, T.S. Eliot emerged as West's next grand cultural spokesman. Paul Valery, also studied here, had asked in his essay The Crisis of the Spirit after World War I regarding the future and the destiny of this Europe. Will it become what it is in reality, a little cape of the Asiatic continent? Or will this Europe remain rather what it seems, the priceless part of the whole earth, the pearl of the globe, the brain of a vast body? Paul Valery's question can be even more succinctly asked today. Will Euro supremacy and Eurocentrism continue as a guiding force of global culture, or has it decisively and definitively seen its day? For West, Eliot's image of Europe as a wasteland, a culture of fragments with no cementing center, is what predominated in post-war Europe. And though his early poetic practices were more radical, open, and international than his Eurocentric criticism, Eliot posed a return to and revision of tradition as the only way of regaining European cultural order and political stability. For Eliot, Europe had become a, quote, nightmare from which he was trying to escape, as well as an immense panorama of futility and anarchy. Eliot's solution was to rethink the notion of tradition in terms not of blind inheritance and repetition, but in terms of individual transformative talent capable of meeting each new historical moment. Like Arnold, Eliot was obsessed with the opposition of civilization and barbarism, decline and decay, and World War II vindicated his pessimistic rather than his optimistic side. For after 1945, the age of Europe was dead. The next intellectual challenge to emerge at this point was, according to West, American exceptionalism. The post-World War II era in the United States, or the first decades of what Henry Luce envisioned as the, quote, American century, not only a period of incredible economic expansion, but of active cultural ferment. During this post-World War II period, American industry created a prosperous middle class rooted predominantly in WASP, or white Anglo-Saxon Protestant ideology, and cultural identity. Non-WASP cultures were marginalized and maligned throughout the 1950s and early 1960s. WASP-based American imperialism did not want to know about or learn from its minorities or others. Against this cultural majority, the influx of Jewish intelligentsia significantly helped to unravel the existing, still Arnoldian, academic consensus. But the humanistic scholars found themselves swept up in the increasing scientific positivism of academic institutions. Older and newer cultural critics like Margaret Mead or Frantz Fanon checked the rising tide of scientism in cultural criticism, the humanities, and the liberal arts. Mass culture, radical politics, and decolonization of the Third World became the major issues of this time. And so West arrives at the fourth intellectual challenge, underlining the new cultural politics of difference, which is the civil rights movement and black power movements. During the late 1950s, 60s, and 70s in the United States, these decolonized sensibilities fanned and fueled the civil rights and black power movements, as well as student anti-war, feminist, gray, brown, gay, and lesbian movements. In this period, we witnessed the shattering of male WASP cultural homogeneity, the inclusion of African Americans, Latino, Latina Americans, Asian Americans, Native Americans, and American women in the culture of critical discourse yielded intense intellectual polemics and inescapable ideological polarizations, focusing principally on the exclusions, silences, and blindnesses of male WASP cultural homogeneity and its concomitant Arnoldian notions of the canon. In addition, these critiques promoted three crucial processes that affected intellectual and artistic life in the country. And first is the appropriation of the theories of post-war Europe, especially the work of the Frankfurt School. Marcuse, Adorno, and Horkheimer studied last week. Second, French and Italian Marxism, such as Sartre, Althusser, Lefebvre, Gramsci, and structuralism, such as Levi Strauss or Todorov. And lastly, post-structuralisms, or so-called postmodernisms, such as Deleuze, Foucault, or Derrida. According to West, these diverse and disparate theories, all preoccupied with keeping alive radical projects after the Age of Europe, all tend to fuse versions of transgressive European modernisms with Marxist or post-Marxist left politics. And importantly, they unanimously shun the term postmodernism. Alongside these hyper-intellectualized developments, there was also for West the recovery and revisioning of American history in light of the struggles of white male workers, African Americans, Native Americans, Latinx Americans, gays and lesbians, as well as the increasing impact of forms of popular culture, such as television, film, music videos, and even sports on more highbrow or intellectual culture. The black-based hip-hop culture of youth around the world is one grand example. More on that soon. In reckoning with the Africana diaspora in the later 20th century, West writes that, needless to say, the European control of culture globally included brutal enslavement, institutional terrorism, and cultural degradation of black diaspora people. the death of roughly 75 million Africans during the centuries-long transatlantic slave trade is but one reminder, among others, of the assault on black humanity, the black diaspora condition of New World servitude, in which they were viewed as commodities with production value, who had no proper legal status, social standing, or public worth, can be characterized as, following Orlando Patterson, natal alienation. More on that concept in a minute with Yetisha Womack and Afrofuturism. For West, this state of perpetual and inheritable domination that diaspora Africans had at birth produced the modern black diaspora problematic of invisibility and namelessness, as in the title of Ralph Ellison's book The Invisible Man, or in the earlier work of Du Bois and Double Consciousness. White supremacist practices enacted under the auspices of prestigious cultural authorities of churches, print media, and scientific academies promoted black inferiority and constituted the European background against which black diaspora struggles for identity, dignity, self-confidence, self-respect, self-esteem, and material resources took place. For a long time, implicit or explicit white supremacist assaults on black intelligence, ability, beauty, and character required persistent black efforts to hold self-doubt, self-contempt, and even self-hatred at bay. When black aesthetics was discussed, up until very recently, in fact, it was always from the point of view of selective appropriation, incorporation, and rearticulation of European ideologies, cultures, and institutions, now seen alongside the African heritage, a heritage more or less confined to linguistic innovation in rhetorical practices, stylizations of the body as forms of occupying an alien social space, such as black hairstyles, ways of walking, standing, talking, and hand expressions, and as means of constituting and sustaining camaraderie and community, many an anthropological and sociological track on black aesthetics, focusing more or less exclusively on antiphonal, call-and-response, Africana styles, rhythmic repetition, and risk-ridden syncopation in spectacular modes in musical and rhetorical expression. These are just a few of the strategies employed by scholars from the 50s to the 90s, through which black aesthetics could be acknowledged while at the same time being minimized or ignored. In fact, even today, the African aesthetic Wikipedia page is a travesty from West's point of view. First, it tells us that, quote, certain standards of beauty and correctness in artistic expression and physical appearance are held in common among various African societies. Then it has a very short entry on what it calls cool aesthetics and refers us to the wiki pages on the Get Down and Etutu, the Yoruba word for cool. That's it. That's all it has. The cool entry makes it look like African and African diaspora aesthetics is basically just the African spirituality of, quote, thumping ecstasy, intense solemnity of mien, facial serenity, bopping and strutting, or showing off. And it quotes Robert Thompson's 1974 study, African Art in Motion, quote, Negro boys have a cool way of walking in which the upper trunk and pelvis rock fore and aft while the head remains stable with the eyes looking straight ahead. The walk is quite slow, and the Negroes take it as a way of strutting or showing off. End quote. That's it. That's literally all you find under the African Wiki, even now at the end of 2021. Somebody has to fix that fast. Kinda shameful, really. West goes on in what he considers the universal problematic in black cultural movements and African aesthetics of overcoming invisibility and namelessness. Every modern black person, especially cultural disseminators, encounters this problematic of invisibility and namelessness. The initial black diaspora response was a mode of resistance that was moralistic in content and communal in character. That is, the fight for representation and recognition highlighted moral judgments regarding black positive images over and against white supremacist stereotypes. These images, such as this one on the left, represented monolithic and homogeneous black communities in a way that could displace past misrepresentations of these communities. For West, these courageous yet limited black efforts to combat racist cultural practices uncritically accepted non-black conventions and standards in two ways. First, they proceeded in an assimilationist manner that set out to show that black people were really like white people, and thereby eliding differences in history and culture between whites and blacks. Black specificity and particularity was thus banished in order to gain white acceptance and approval. Second, these black responses rested upon a homogenizing impulse that assumed that all black people were really alike, hence obliterating differences, class, gender, region, sexual orientation between black people. Here West writes that there are elements of truth in both claims. yet the conclusions are unwarranted owing to the basic fact that non-black paradigms set the terms of the reply. Any notion of the quote real black community or positive images were value-laden, socially loaded, and ideologically charged from the start. This phase in black aesthetics from the 50s to the 70s could be understood as one of the phases of the construction or reconstruction of black identity. For West, Hall has rightly called this encounter the end of innocence or the end of the innocent notion of the essential black subject, and the recognition that black is essentially politically and culturally constructed category. In other words, blackness as a racial identity simply has no essentialist basis, a point we'll hear about more when we turn to Yatisha Womack later. For West, this recognition, more and more pervasive among the postmodern black diaspora intelligentsia, is facilitated in part by the slow but sure dissolution of the European age's maritime empires and the unleashing of new political possibilities and cultural articulations among ex-colonized people across the globe. Most of these earlier art movements were from the black male left, but the decisive push of postmodern black intellectuals towards the new cultural politics of difference has been made by the powerful critiques and constructive explorations of black diaspora women. West here gives special mention to Toni Morrison, but we must also mention bell hooks, Angela Davis, and many others. It's interesting that the second phase of the black cultural arts movement, and the move from construction to intersection, was pioneered by black feminism. According to West, quote, the coffin used to bury the innocent notion of the essentialist black subject was nailed shut with the termination of the black male monopoly on the construction of the black subject. In this regard, the black diaspora womanist critique has had greater impact than the critiques that highlighted exclusively class, empire, age, sexual orientation, or nature. Following the model of the black diaspora traditions of music, athletics, and rhetoric, black cultural workers must now constitute and sustain discursive and institutional networks that deconstruct earlier modern black strategies for identity formation and learn to demystify power relations by incorporating class, patriarchal, and homophobic biases, and thereby constructing a more multivalent and multidimensional response that articulates the complexity and diversity of black practices in the modern and postmodern world. This was pretty prophetic of West to point out in 1990. In fact, black feminism has, in the last three decades, had an even deeper impact in deconstructing earlier black strategies for identity formation and demystifying power relations. Its more, now generally called intersectional approach, has more than any other field in Africana studies taught us to incorporate class, patriarchal, and homophobic biases, as well as to construct more multivalent and multidimensional responses to the complexity and diversity of black practices in the modern and postmodern world. Here, West turns to a fork in the road in regards to how we are to approach the new cultural politics of difference. On the one hand, demystification, the path we should travel, and on the other, reductionism, the danger. According to West, demystification is the most illuminating mode of theoretical inquiry for those who promote the new cultural politics of difference. Social structural analyses of empire, exterminism, class, race, gender, nature, age, sexual orientation, nation, and region are the springboards, though not the landing grounds, for the most desirable forms of critical practice that take history and her story seriously. West defines demystificatory criticism as prophetic criticism and calls it the approach most appropriate to the new cultural politics because while it begins with social structural analyses, it also makes explicit its moral and political aims. West is not arguing for a decanonizing of the classics in any art genre, nor for an insular emphasis on cultural integrity or purity, whether it be white or black, but rather for a livelier, more open-minded conversation across traditions. The deadly trap of demystification in any form of prophetic criticism is reductionism, whether it be of a sociological, psychological, or historical sort. Quote, by reductionism, I mean either one-factor analyses, such as crude Marxisms, feminisms, or racialisms, that yield a one-dimensional functionalism, or a hyper-subtle analytical perspective that loses touch with the specificity of an artwork's form and the context of its reception. West's utopian hope is this: few cultural workers of whatever stripe can walk the tightrope between the scula of reductionism and the corruptus of aestheticism, and yet demystifying prophetic critics must. Here, West in 1990 doesn't seem to hold out high hopes for analytic philosophy and analytic aesthetics to make more than a marginal contribution to the new cultural politics of difference. When he does talk about the history of analytic philosophy in this piece, he refers to its role in bolstering post-war jargons of scientificity. I wonder if he would consider his criticisms as still applying to more recent work in analytic aesthetics. On the other hand, and interestingly, although not included in all versions of this piece, West highlights Heidegger, Derrida, and Richard Rorty, it was 1990, remember, as traditions containing important resources for the new cultural politics, resources relevant for meeting the intellectual challenges faced in BIPOC cultural and artistic projects. On Heidegger, West writes that despite the abominable Nazi associations, his analysis of the suppression of temporality and historicity in the dominant traditions of Western philosophy are very important. In fact, Michael E. Sawyer has since published An Africana Philosophy of Temporality, Homo Liminalis, a pioneering Heideggerian work in Africana studies, and well worth picking up for any philosopher. The problem with Heidegger, West correctly underlines, is his ethnocentric and Eurocentric view of history in terms of the Greeks and the Germans, fate, heritage, and destiny. Heidegger, quote, dramatizes the past and present as if it were a Greek tragedy, with no tools of social analyses to relate cultural work to institutions and structures or antecedent forms and styles. Derrida's approach is for West more promising in its skeptical emphasis on deconstructing the power of binaristic rhetorical operations. White-black, good-bad, male-female, machine-nature, ruler-ruled, etc. What Derrida does is to refuse hierarchical arrangement of these terms, and his approach is subtle and deliberately transgressive. It falls short for West when it puts a, quote, premium on the sophisticated, ironic consciousness that tends to preclude and foreclose analyses that guide action with a purpose. However, West even excuses Derrida this shortcoming due to his, quote, own status as an Algerian-born Jewish leftist marginalized by the French academic establishment. Here we might briefly digress on a loose Derridian analysis of Black Lives Matter versus All Lives Matter. For All Lives Matter, activists may think they are being ironic or post-racial or even deconstructing white versus black identity politics, even privilege, or taking into account universal humanity, etc. In fact, their utterances are not attuned to the meaning of their words within the Black Lives Matter context. Specifically, they fail to mourn the asymmetrical experiences of BIPOC people in America. A Derridian might explain, it is only with the notion of language as fallen from presence, only with the process of language as mourning, that an original presence is affected. And two, a word can have meaning or work in a context only if I recognize its continued sense beyond what is said here and now. These two hallmarks of Derridian deconstructive hermeneutics encourage a generous and mournful, i.e. Derridian, response to engagement with the meaning of our words for others beyond our own contexts. And this is perhaps what is most lacking when people use phrases like All Lives Matter as a response to the Black Lives Matter movement. That being a more in-depth account of West's intellectual challenges in the face of the new cultural politics, we can do a briefer summary of the existential and political challenges. Again, he asks, how does one acquire the resources to survive and the cultural capital to thrive as a critic or artist? And notes that the profoundly racist and sexist heritage of the European age has bequeathed to us a set of deeply ingrained perceptions about people of color, including, of course, the self-perceptions that people of color bring. The new cultural politics of difference advises critics and artists of color to put aside their mental bondage, especially what he calls the white normative gaze, and thereby freeing themselves to both interrogate the ways in which they are bound by certain conventions and to learn from and build on these very norms and models. There are four options here in the path of all black cultural workers and artists, and each of them for West has a distinctive trap. One, a black artist may seek legitimation in the mainstream, the trap here being selling out within the white patronage system. Two, a black artist may pursue subcultural group insularity, the danger here being lack of broad-minded impact. Three, a black artist might go it alone, and for West, every great artist goes through this phase eventually. But the best option for black culture workers and artists is for West to become critical organic catalysts. And we'll see quite a few excellent examples of what West means by this when we turn to Afrofuturist artists later in this lecture. On the political challenge, West writes that while much of the First World intelligentsia continues to adopt retrospective and conservative outlooks that defend the crisis-ridden present, the new we of the new cultural politics should promote a perspective and prophetic vision with a sense of possibility and potentiality, especially for those who bear the social costs of the present. To put it boldly, the new kind of critic and artist associated with the new cultural politics of difference consists of an energetic breed of new world bricoleurs with improvisational and flexible sensibilities that sidestep mere opportunism and mindless eclecticism. I wonder how widely West's 1990 piece was read by subsequent Black culture workers and artists. It continues today to be a seminal piece in the field, hence its inclusion in our anthology of aesthetics. And I think West himself was pleasantly surprised by the impact of this essay in various spheres of Black culture from 1990 to the present. Let's transition now to a brief account of the history of hip-hop and then Afrofuturism. And here I might recommend you begin by pressing pause and reading the Wikipedia pages on Africana Studies, Hip-Hop and Afrofuturism. And you might also watch or rewatch The Get Down on Netflix, which is Lars von Trier's take on the birth of hip-hop culture in the Bronx in the 1970s, or watch or rewatch Black Panther from 2018, alongside the Democracy Now! Interview panel about Black Panther. So let's talk about Black aesthetics in the work first of Tricia Rose on the emergence and recent history of the hip-hop revolution, and then Yetisha Womack on Afrofuturism. As the wiki introduces Tricia Rose, she is an American sociologist and author who more or less single-handedly put scholarship on hip-hop on the academic map. Her studies mainly probe the intersectionality of pop music and gender. Now at Brown University, she's professor of Africana Studies and the director of the Center for the Study of Race and Ethnicity in America. And Rose now co-hosts a podcast, The Tightrope, alongside Cornel West. In fact, right before COVID hit, the two were scheduled to give a talk at our very own union at CSUS, but it was canceled, alas. After her pioneering book Black Noise in 1994, 4 years after West's essay, she more recently published The Hip-Hop Wars, What We Talk About When We Talk About Hip-Hop and Why It Matters, and other works, which examines what happened to the hip-hop music industry and culture since the 1990s. And you can watch several of her talks in these fields on YouTube, especially Hip-Hop Wars from 2014 and her earlier talk Hip-Hop Futures. Here I'll just be citing a few passages from her Black Noise book on the origins of hip-hop, and giving a brief summary of its more recent history. According to Rose, rap music and hip-hop culture are cultural, political, and commercial forms, and for many young people, they are the primary cultural, sonic, and linguistic windows into the world. So what is the art form known as hip-hop, and what are we talking about when we talk about hip-hop aesthetics? Hip-hop is a multi-genre, community-based art form which sounds, once we look at its components, quite a lot like Greek musicae. The form combines a vocal component, emceeing or rapping, and rhythmic beatboxing, a musical component involving DJing or scratching on turntables or other musical instruments, a gestural component such as breakdancing, something that came about thanks to Brazilian immigrants of the time practicing their native martial arts, capoeira, out in the streets, as well as a visual component involving graffiti or graph writing, as well as other elements such as sampling beats or bass lines from records or synthesizing beats and sounds, using at first analog and now increasingly digital technologies. Hip-hop invariably involves sampling, versioning, or what's known as quilting, similar to bricolage, and perhaps the core concept of its aesthetics can be summed up in the term remixology. All musical, linguistic, and gestural forms are fair game. Framed this way, some of you might be thinking back to the beginning of this course when we studied Greek musical aesthetics or Greek musicae. It as well was the archa or ur art form, and it as well combined vocal or linguistic, musical, gestural, and visual elements, even having its own version of sampling or remixology in its relationship to mythical traditions. Hip-hop aesthetics, we could say, is a fully embodied aesthetics, but what's new here is that A, arriving at the end of the 20th century, it pioneers the use of all available technologies in music and cultural performance, and B, it emerges at a particular socio-political moment, initially the art genre of African diasporic populations in American urban centers. It becomes an international art and music movement. Tricia Rose's first book, Black Noise, involved an extensive account of hip-hop's origin in the Bronx where she grew up. It emerged in the rich interrelation of rap, graffiti, and breakdancing, and reflected both breaks and continuities with other Afro-diasporic musical traditions, emerging as distinct from blues, jazz, R&B, disco, and soul, and as both a direct and indirect response to economic and social conditions of marginalization in American society. Its origins were in the South Bronx among diverse Afro-diasporic cultures, including North American blacks, Jamaicans, Puerto Ricans, and other Caribbean people. Again, if you haven't yet, you should really watch pretty amazing Netflix TV series The Get Down, or a fictionalized account of this history. From these origins in the Bronx, hip-hop emerges as a source of alternative identity and potential success for young people who felt disinherited from the American dream. And it goes on to serve this function in the Global Village as well. Regarding the tensions of how we're to approach the topic of hip-hop aesthetics, Trisha Rose asks some pretty interesting questions. Is hip-hop a postmodern practice or a pre-modern oral tradition? Is it a critique of consumer capitalism or a complicity with commercialism? Is it the performance of new transformative identities or the phantasmagoria of late capitalist subjectivity? Her answer is pretty much that it is both and neither. What studying hip-hop most invites us to reconsider is the role of the digital imagination in late industrial society and its politics of pleasure. A few quotes from her book Black Noise. Life on the margins of post-industrial urban America is inscribed in hip-hop style, sound, lyrics, and thematics. Situated at the crossroads of lack and desire, hip-hop emerges from the de-industrialization meltdown where social alienation, prophetic imagination, and yearning intersect. Hip-hop is a cultural form that attempts to negotiate the experiences of marginalization, brutally truncated opportunity, and oppression within the cultural imperatives of African-American and Caribbean history, identity, and community. It is the tension between the cultural fractures produced by post-industrial oppression and the binding ties of Black cultural expressivity that set the critical frame for the development of hip-hop. Inside of the economic constraints from which it was born and the commercial constraints under which it grew, rap music offers alternative interpretations of key social events, such as the Gulf War, the Los Angeles Uprising, police brutality, censorship efforts, and community-based education. It is the central cultural vehicle for open social reflection on poverty, fear of adulthood, the desire for absent fathers, frustrations about Black male sexism, female sexual desires, daily rituals of life as an unemployed teen hustler, safe sex, raw anger, violence, and childhood memories. It is also the home of innovative uses of style and language, hilariously funny carnivalesque and Chitlin Circuit-inspired dramatic skits, and ribald storytelling. In short, it is Black America's most dynamic contemporary popular cultural, intellectual, and spiritual vessel. And from its origin to the present day, one of its most promising social functions is unifying Black communities. For example, after the Los Angeles riots, author Mike Davis attended an Inglewood Crip and Blood gang truce meeting in which gang members voiced impassioned testimonials and called for unity and political action. Describing their speeches, Davis said, "These guys were very eloquent. They spoke in a rap rhythm and with rap eloquence, which I think kind of shook up the white television crews." Later, Davis noted that the gang truce and political struggles articulated in that meeting were translated into the hip-hop musical culture. And so hip-hop, Davis concludes, is the fundamental matrix of self-expression, especially political self-expression, for this whole generation. You'll have to read Trisha Rose's two books on hip-hop for a more in-depth account of its aesthetics, history, and development. But some of the early hip-hop hits she singles out for mention are songs by Sugar Hill Gang, Rapper's Delight, Grandmaster Flash and the Furious Five, The Message, or A Tribe Called Quest, Can I Kick It? De La Soul's Break of Dawn, Brand Nubians, Wake Up, Black Sheep, The Choice Is Yours, or Tone Lock's Funky Cold Medina, Public Enemies, Can't Trust It. One of the topics Trisha Rose writes most lucidly about is the history of Black women in hip-hop, noting how, in fact, in the early days, Black female rappers and MCs were legion and very successful. It was the commercial rise of gangsterism, with its violence and misogyny, that changed the situation drastically in the hip-hop music industry. And here you can go down memory lane by listening to Roxanne Shanti's Roxanne's Revenge, or the new Netflix original on her, Roxanne Roxanne, Queen Latifah's Unity, MC Light's Poor Georgia, or Salt-N-Pepa's Let's Talk About Sex. By the mid to late 1990s, a phenomena took place in the industry, which is probably best described as the gangsterization of hip-hop. This ended up being the hip-hop that was most commercially successful in North America and internationally, and which significantly served to dilute and blunt hip-hop's message of conscious revolutions, social justice. This is the last still the hip-hop that everyone is most familiar with. Ice-T's original gangster, Ice Cube, It Was a Good Day, Dr. Dre and Snoop Dogg, Nothing But a G-Thing, Ice-T's Gin and Juice, or Ghetto Boys, Damn It Feels Good to Be a Gangster. Here, the cultural backdrop of hip-hop transformed from the context of Spike Lee's original She's Gotta Have It and Do the Right Thing to black male ghetto films such as Colors, New Jack City, Boys in the Hood, Juice and Menace to Society. Rose underlines two problems here, bequeathed to us by the legacy of gangsterization. First, people want to imagine aggrievement, even antisocial criminal violence, is fundamentally resistive. It isn't. The fact of it being hip-hop doesn't make a freedom-fighting anti-racist message or influence. During this period, depictions of women as bitches and hoes came to prominence, and black women came to be represented as mere Nubian nymphs, whose presence merely conferred authority on male MCs. Second, this form of hip-hop became the commercial juggernaut that perpetuated the most destructive stereotypes about black people and communities. The range of stories and narratives told narrowed significantly, and conscious hip-hop went underground. The racial messages in gangster rap pretty much confirmed white prejudices about black male and ghetto communities, sexual danger, violence, gangs, drugs, and conspicuous consumption. The hip-hop trinity of gangsters, pimps, and hoes was born, and politicians like Joe Biden took the bait in 1993 when they argued for mandatory minimums for simple drug possession and called young black males, many of them part of this gangster culture, super predators. Alongside the gangsterization of hip-hop, white communities across North America and internationally also adopt the hip-hop art genre and aesthetic. Here, the first three big hits were Beastie Boys' Hit It, Vanilla Ice, Ice Ice Baby, and House of Pain, Jump Around. You'd think that growing up in Ottawa, Canada would be more or less a wholesome experience. Well, it wasn't. The city youth culture was more or less wholly determined by the worship of gangster rappers. Although we never thought very much of Toronto's own Vanilla Ice. Looking at these historical developments and pursuing her academic career, Trisha Rose was motivated in 2008 to write a companion book to Black Noise, The Hip-Hop Wars. For the tone of the book here, we can begin by reading the blurb on the back. Hip-hop is a distinctive form of black art in America from Tupac to the Pulitzer Prize-winning Kendrick Lamar, and has long given voice to the African-American experience. As scholar and cultural critic Trisha Rose argues, hip-hop in fact is one of the primary ways we talk about race in the United States. But hip-hop is in crisis. For years, the most commercially successful hip-hop has become increasingly saturated with caricatures of black gangsters, thugs, pimps, and hoes. This both represents and feeds a problem in black American culture. Or does it? In Hip Hop Wars, Rose explores the most crucial issues underlining the polarized claims on each side of the debate. Does hip-hop cause violence or merely reflect a violent ghetto culture? Is hip-hop sexist or are its detractors simply anti-sexist? Does the portrayal of black culture in hip-hop undermine black advancement? A potent exploration of a divisive and important subject, Hip Hop Wars concludes with a call for regalvanization of the progressive and creative heart of hip-hop. What Rose calls for is not a sanitized vision of the form, but one that more accurately reflects a much richer space of culture, politics, anger, and yes, sex, than the current ubiquitous images and sound and video currently provide. Trisha Rose is not saying that the cultural avatars of hip-hop from the late 90s to 2008 are not talented and creative. She is saying, quote, "Beware the manipulation of the funk." For during this time, white corporate consolidation of the mass media and hip-hop industry pushed out most of the positive messages, promoting instead dysfunctional cultural narratives. Why did this happen? Well, because everybody was buying it, especially voyeuristic white culture attempting to ghettoize itself. Hip-hop became a cash cow and progressive visionary hip-hop artists marginalized, even to this day when artists like Sage Francis or Janelle Monáe are virtually unknown compared to Drake, Kanye, or Lil Wayne, etc. People still looking for a last-minute presentation topic might want to look into the growing literature on hip-hop and philosophy. I would particularly recommend Julius Bailey's book, Philosophy and Hip-Hop, Ruminations on Postmodern Cultural Form. And amazingly, hip-hop has even been read in light of Hegel and Hegelian dialectics in Jim Vernon's Hip-Hop, Hegel, and the Art of Emancipation. Let's turn now to the topic of Afrofuturism. As the wiki defines it, it is a cultural aesthetic, philosophy of science, and philosophy of history that explores the developing intersection of African diaspora culture with technology. The term was coined by Mark Derry in 1993 and explored in the 1990s by Alondra Nelson. Here our guide will be Atisha Womack, a Chicago-based scholar, filmmaker, and dance therapist with a BA in mass media and graduate work in philosophy, who quite recently wrote the first book surveying the scope of this field. As West Coast Canadian scholar Tobias Van Veen praises the book with its first-person narrative, easygoing interview quotes, overview of Afrofuturism's scholarly history, artistic and musical traditions, and numerous references to past and contemporary Afrofuturist works. This book is useful for newcomers and adherents alike. Through her concise and self-reflective reportage, Yetisha Womack has explicated Afrofuturism's concepts, artists, and works with ease and sophistication. No small feat. You can also check out her 2017 film, A Love Letter to the Ancestors from Chicago, or her co-curated with Janelle Monáe, Black to the Future Afrofuturist playlist on Spotify. Womack begins her first chapter, Evolution of a Space Cadet, with childhood reflections on the release of the Star Wars series. She writes, quote, "When I was in the fourth grade, I was Princess Leia for Halloween, the princess and born leader of the rebel forces in Star Wars Episode 4, A New Hope. Leia was my heroine in elementary school. It is a distinct memory because wearing all white with a wooden sword on your hip in a rainstorm and trying to explain you're a cosmic princess to candy-giving neighbors isn't a memory you forget. With two giant braids twisted into coils and pinned neatly on either side of my head, I found the idea of being a galactic princess with guts and brains to be pretty cool. Later, I would fully understand the myth of the Force and the archetypal battles between ego and light that render Star Wars fans so enthusiastic. But as a kid, I was a bit more infatuated with lightsabers and Ewoks, and just glad that Luke and Leia didn't fall in love because they were Jedi siblings. While it was fun to be the chick from outer space in my imagination, the quest to see myself or browner people in this space-age galactic epic was important to me. Through the eyes of a child, the absence of such imagery didn't escape me. For one, I secretly wished that Lando Calrissian, played by sex symbol Billy Dean Williams, hadn't lost the Millennium Falcon in a bet, then maybe he, and not Han Solo, would have had more screen time navigating the solar systems. I also wish that when Darth Vader's face was revealed, it would have been the actor James Earl Jones, the real-life voice behind the mask, and not the British thespian David Prowse who emerged. Then again, I also wished that Princess Leia and not Luke had been the first sibling trained in the way of the Jedi, and I could have carried a lightsaber at Halloween instead of my broken wooden sword." Thus beginning her work with the question of black representation in American popular culture, Womack next describes her own attempt of a fantasy series with core Afrofuturist narrative, Rayla, 2212 and 2213. The character Rayla is a rebel strategist and third-generation citizen of Planet Hope, an Earth colony gone rogue some 200 years into the future. Her nickname is Princess, and she's charged with finding Mulan Shakur, note the Disney and Tupac shoutouts, a mysterious scientist who trains her to find the missing. The journey takes her across worlds and lifetimes, and she's a browner woman. You can check out Womack's science fiction, read by the author on Audible. On the need for Afrofuturism, Womack remarks, "It's one thing when black people aren't discussed in world history. Fortunately, teams of dedicated historians and culture advocates have chipped away at the propaganda often functioning as history for the world's students to eradicate that glaring error. But when, even in imaginary futures, a space where the mind can stretch beyond the Milky Way to envision routine space travel, cuddly space animals, talking apes and time machines, people can't even fathom a person of non-Euro descent 100 years into the future, a cosmic foot has to be put down." Indeed, sci-fi movies from the 50s through the 90s invariably depict black characters as having a tragic fate. Black characters might also be shown as the silent mystical types or scary witch doctors, but they are never central. According to Womack, the Matrix and Avatar movies helped change that. Roger Ebert even asked after watching The Matrix if its creators envisioned a future world dominated by black people. Also, Denzel Washington, Wesley Snipes, and Will Smith redefined the role of black male protagonists in film. Afrofuturism goes even further, as Van Veen and Rinaldo put this, quote, "With films like The Get Down 2017 and Black Panther 2018, attaining worldwide critical acclaim, Afrofuturism has become something of a buzzword in global pop culture, taking on a sense of cultural capital and cachet. As a general term, it expresses the speculative utopias and futurist themes of black science fiction and circulates in interviews, articles, and soundbites surrounding Hollywood films, celebrity artists and musicians, superhero franchises, and comic books. And yet its meaning is often limited in various ways. On the one channel, Afrofuturism is described as an inventory of black futurist aesthetics, androids, cyborgs, superheroes, and alien motifs, with little thought to how its aesthetic symbols and their hybrid identities potentially question underlying paradigms of race and identity that both inform and deform cultural assumptions concerning blackness. On the other channel, Afrofuturism is viewed as a futurist extension of Afrocentricity, where its authenticity is indexed to its politics of representation and its symbols recuperated towards essentialist notions of black culture. In asking what is Afrofuturism, Womack provides a definition that it's the intersection of imagination, technology, the future, and liberation. Ingrid LaFleur defines Afrofuturism as a way of imagining possible futures through a black cultural lens, a way to encourage experimentation, reimagine identities, and activate liberation. As Womack puts this, whether through literature, visual arts, music, or grassroots organizing, Afrofuturists redefine culture and notions of blackness for today and the future. Both an artistic aesthetic and a framework for critical theory, Afrofuturism combines elements of science fiction, historical fiction, speculative fiction, fantasy, Afrocentricity, and magic realism with non-Western beliefs. In some cases, it's a total re-envisioning of the past and speculation about the future rife with cultural critiques. The history of the term Afrofuturism begins with Mark Derry's 1994 essay, Black to the Future, where he writes that mainstream science fiction takes inspiration from things that are going on in society, but often does not include the viewpoint of those in the African diaspora. In the spirit of filling this gap, the artists and writers in the Afrofuturist tradition seek to include us in the future settings that we are often left out of. Reynaldo Anderson writes that Afrofuturism, like post-blackness, destabilizes previous analyses of blackness. What I like about Afrofuturism is that it helps create our own space in the future. It allows us to control our imagination. An Afrofuturist is not ignorant of history, but they don't let history restrain their creative impulses either. According to Womack, Derry ushered in serious study of cyberculture and gave a name to the technoculture trends in Black America. Music and culture writers like Greg Tate, Mark Sinker, and Kodwo Eshun were then among the earliest Afrofuturist theorists, paralleling Derry's interest. However, the roots of this aesthetic began decades before. With the emergence of Afrofuturism as a philosophical study in the 90s, suddenly artists like avant-garde jazz legend Sun Ra, funk pioneer George Clinton, and sci-fi authors like Octavia Butler were rediscovered and reframed by Afrofuturists as social change agents. Writing in the UK context of the Cybernetic Culture Research Unit in the late 90s, Kodwo Eshun's book, More Brilliant Than the Sun, Adventures in Sonic Fiction, remains in many ways an unsurpassable philosophical work in this field, especially for its pioneering application of Deleuze and Guattari as a philosophical framework. Eshun also connected what he called Black Atlantic Futurism to the work of Paul Gilroy and traced its roots and roots with an ear to its sonic practices in jazz, funk, dub, and electronic music. The book theorizes Black Sonic Futurism as the framework for an anti-essentialist, post-humanist philosophy of Black cyborg ontology and aesthetics, combining music, radical performance, and lived science fiction. So within the general frame that Afrofuturists write their own story, what are the specific themes of the genre? Womack highlights four. One, Afrofuturists explore the role of science and technology in the Black experience. Two, they're deeply engaged in the history and future of Black musical innovations. Three, they frequently explore sci-fi themes of alien abduction, especially in relation to the transatlantic slave trade. And four, they explore the missing history of the Africana diaspora and its reintegration and new cultural landmarks in the post-colonial digital and cybertech future. The movement in the 1990s was almost unthinkable without the invention of the internet and the ALO listserv on Afrofuturism, which explored blackness and technology, space, freedom, culture, sci-fi, and the arts. Its first moderators were Alondra Nelson and DJ Spooky, i.e. that subliminal kid or Paul Miller, who became famous for his touring DJ remix of Griffith's early film, The Birth of a Nation. Various other internet communities followed. In fact, Womack was already studying Afrofuturism at Clark Atlanta. She recalls how her cohort discussed hip-hop lyrics, Genesis, quantum mechanics, music theory, film aesthetics, African philosophy, Du Boisian double consciousness, and Parliament Funkadelic, often all in the same breath. This curriculum in many ways developed from Sun Ra's own eclectic intellectual interests already in the 1950s and 60s. One of her co-travelers into this realm, Kamafi, had a fascinating to Womack take on Parliament or Funkadelic. And she writes that at the time, I didn't see the depth of One Nation under a groove or Freak of the Week. beyond their mesmerizing bass lines, but he, Kamafi, her Philly-born honors history and physics major, and a Dubuisian, proceeded to explain the Parliament funkadelic cosmology. A winding galactic tale in which funk doubled as the force, a la Star Wars, in a space-age tale that poised wrongdoers against light-seekers, all told in a series of albums. Kamafi echoed the double entendres in the work and the multiple layers in various lyrics. And just when I was about to argue that he was making the whole thing up, I realized that he was onto something. Indeed, the Afrofuturist aesthetic in music began popping up in hip-hop and neo-soul lyrics. Songstress Erykah Badu, who minored in physics while attending Grambling University, another historically black college and university, made casual references to P-Funk mothership and quantum physics. Between the streams of college kids who wanted to debate Star Wars and the unearthing of P-Funk in 90s-era hip-hop, the brewing of an aesthetic was obvious. And here are a few lyrical excerpts from P-Funk's mothership connection. Well, alright, Star Child, children of the universe, recording angels, we have returned to claim the pyramids. Partying on the mothership, I am the mothership connection. Star Child here, citizens of the universe, getting it on. Partying on the mothership, when Gabriel's horn blows, you'd better be ready to go. Parliament and Funkadelic, or P-Funk's Mothership Connection, was in some ways the black community's equivalent to the Grateful Dead tours or the Later Fish. As we hear elsewhere, swing low, time to move on, light years in time, ahead of our time, free your mind and come fly with me. It's hip on the mothership, grooving. Swing down, sweet chariot stop, and let me ride. Over the years, Womack became fascinated with the growing number of artists she encountered who were developing art exploring people of color in the future, each immersed in works with a strong sci-fi and historical fiction themes, often flirting with Eastern or African philosophy, and all utilizing black characters or aesthetics to deconstruct images of the past to re-visualize the future. Not only Erykah Badu, Outkast, or DJ Spooky, but also Nicole Mitchell, a jazz flautist, Octavia Butler, the sci-fi author, Chris Adams and Jonathan Wood, film directors, and Dinesh Akpem, an artist professor and the first to teach Afrofuturism, and many more artist professors since, all turned to black sci-fi and fantasy as a platform to assess humanity's issues. Indeed, although Sun Ra's application to be an artist in residence for NASA was rejected, it wasn't long before NASA and space exploration became a leading Afrofuturist symbol in the fight for desegregation and civil rights. Mae Jemison became the first African-American woman in space, and her radio program, Race and the Space Race, tells the unlikely story of civil rights and the space program. And you can hear Mae Jemison's story here in her own words in the link below. After thus introducing the field of Afrofuturist studies, Womack goes on to talk about race as a fiction. And the central question one of her professors once asked her, what came first, racism or slavery? According to Womack, her classmates at the time, all of whom considered themselves to be quasi-black history experts, were firm in their answer. Of course, racism came first, right? We believe that those who led the transatlantic slave trade and infused laws to support it had an intrinsic belief that people of darker skin were inferior, and thus they enslaved them. But we were wrong. Slavery, said the professor, came first, and racism was created to justify it. We argued with her because for us it simply didn't make any sense. Race, we believed, always existed, but race, we soon realized, despite our pride, was a creation too. According to Smith, who Womack cites, blackness is a technology. It's not real. It's a thing, i.e. a cultural artifact. Dorothy Roberts, a medical ethics advocate, calls race the fatal invention. And there's still today much pushback to the recognition that race is a construction and fiction. Even the Nation of Islam founder Elijah Muhammad thought that the white races were invented by an evil scientist. And one anger caller once asked Roberts, well, if race is an invention and not real, how do you explain racism? Robert shared that the politics and social measures, as well as the laws and injustices around race, are real. However, race is not some default biological category, although it is a social and political identity. Womack next turns to two modern socio-political prophecies which seem bizarrely to intersect: the prophecies of transhumanism and of the majority-minority America. Transhumanists believe in maximizing human potential and look to exceed human limitations, physical and otherwise, with new medicine, nanotechnology, or robotic culture. Some transhumanists boldly claim that by 2045, humans will officially merge with machines. Ironic, Womack thinks, because that same decade is predicted to mark the beginning of the majority-minority America. Actually, the prophecies are just 1 year apart. 2044 and 2045, on the question of humanism and post-human futures, Womack then turns to the legacy of slavery. At one point in history, just as monarchies challenged Galileo on his Earth revolving around the sun theory, scientists and profiteers argued about just who was human and who was not. A color-based, sex-based hierarchy was formed largely to regulate those who had access to the world's resources and the rights of self-determination, and who did not. She goes on, "The concept is a weird one. One of the most difficult ideas for descendants of enslaved Africans to swallow is that at one point in time, our ancestors were not deemed human. This wasn't just an opinion, but rather a legal status encoded in the first version of the US Constitution. By law, enslaved Africans were three-fifths human. None of the rights to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness that we so proudly celebrate today were extended to women, Native Americans, or anyone who was not a white male. Citizenship rights were granted only to those who were legally human." On Thaddeus Stevens' heartbreaking argument for equality under the law and the passing of the 13th Amendment, Womack turns to Spielberg's film Lincoln and the pivotal scene in which radical Republican and anti-slavery advocate Stevens is drilled by his fellow congressman on whether blacks and whites are equal under God or just equal under the law. To convince pro-slavery lawmakers to pass the 13th Amendment abolishing slavery, Stevens had to go against his own code of ethics and emphasize that the soon-to-be-freed slave should be equal under the law and no more. Watching this dramatic negotiation of human status by lawmakers was heart-wrenching. And having been historically considered less than human, Afrofuturist thinkers analyzed the African diaspora as an instance of real alien abduction. As Derry already identified these parallels in Black to the Future, African Americans are, in a very real sense, the descendants of alien abductees. The whites were the aliens in the African continent who did the abducting, and in turn, the abducted blacks became the aliens denied humanity and citizenship. And so Derry compares the atrocities of racism experienced by blacks in the United States to a sci-fi nightmare in which unseen but no less impassable force fields of intolerance frustrate their movement. To a sci-fi nightmare, the official history undoing and repressing what had really been done, and white technology being brought to bear on black bodies. Branding, forced sterilization, the Tuskegee experiment, and tasers come readily to mind. Accordingly, the theme of alien abduction is often explored in Afrofuturist film. District 9, a film set in South Africa about segregated alien settlements, was inspired by the horrors of Cape Town's District 6 during the apartheid era. Avatar is another example of a thinly veiled commentary on imperialism and indigenous cultures. And The Brothers from Another Planet depicts an extraterrestrial in the form of a black man confused by the racial norms of the day. At the core of Afrofuturist aesthetics is what Womack calls Project Imagination. For imagination, hope, and the expectation for transformative change is a through line that undergirds most Afrofuturistic art, literature, music, and criticism. The emphasis on imagination is a collective weighted belief that anchors this aesthetic, for imagination is the prism through which ways of life are created. It's a view of the world, for where there is no imaginative vision, the people perish. In tracing the history of Project Imagination in the Afrofuturist movement, Womack, in a later chapter, goes back to Sun Ra, the jazz ingenue and Afrofuturism's founding pillar, who, as mentioned, had sent in an artist-in-resident application to NASA shortly before the dawn of the space age, but was rejected. Sun Ra, an Alabama-born musician, claimed Saturn as his mythical home and believed that music and technology could heal and transform the world. He was spellbound by the possibilities of space travel and electric technology, and his ideas have never died. A half century later, a pop artist with tech love and Afrofuturist sensibilities would create a song that Martians could hear. What Womack is alluding to here is the first music set space-casted to Mars and back again. Sun Ra is indeed the cosmic ground floor of the Afrofuturist aesthetic movement. As in the group chant of the Sun Ra Orchestra, we travel the spaceways from planet to planet. And as he once explained, "I never wanted to be a part of planet Earth, but I am compelled to be here, so anything I do for this planet is because the master creator of the universe is making me do it. I am of another dimension. I am on this planet because people need me." In an interview with Jazz's magazine, he recalls, "They really thought I was some kind of kook with all my talk about outer space and the planets. I'm still talking about it, but governments are spending billions of dollars to go to Venus and Mars and other planets, so it's no longer kooky to talk about space." For Sun Ra, it had never been a matter of mere oddness when he talks about his Saturnian origins are about observing the planets and traveling the spaceways of going into space, it is more than a lavishly elaborated metaphor, as it might seem to those unaware of the spiritual side of things. Sun Ra's music transcends earthbound limitations by riding the flights of imagination, and his message is that all of us are free to ride those flights with him if we have the precision and the discipline to do so. According to Womack, if there is a cosmic ground floor for the existence of Afrofuturism in music, Sun Ra and George Clinton would be the foundation. They both promoted the idea of a song mythology from the cosmos, high-flying African-inspired space costumes, wordplay that challenged logic, and the use of traditional and electronic instruments to redefine sounds and push for universal love. Both are referenced more than any other artist for the inspiration for today's Afrofuturists. Clinton, whose funk sounds came to the forefront in the 1970s, himself spoke of being inspired above all by Sun Ra, who began creating sonar sounds for the space age already in the 1950s. What Womack appreciates most about Parliament, Funkadelic, and Sun Ra is that they were speaking African spirituals in code. Almost like the old Negro spirituals, they were talking about three things in one line. And you almost have to be in the club to understand, says Sean Wallace, composer and arranger, who noted that the best in hip-hop lyricism uses the same type of layered language. Sun Ra was not only a profound innovator in music, but also in education, and his role in developing an anti-Eurocentric, either Afrocentrist or Afrofuturist canon often goes unsung. As Womack puts this, in a time when Chicago's South Side was littered with jazz bands and clubs, Sun Ra was a fixture on the scene because he adopted the flashlights, solar helmets, and sci-fi African garb that would come to be his trademark. He was known as one of the most scholarly musicians around and would frequently hand out literature about his theories in Washington Park. His canon of must-reads included books on theosophy, numerology, metaphysics, science fiction, biblical studies, and a glut of underground alternative history books and African history books. He was propelled to answer what others hadn't questioned, and gravitated to books with theories on the origins of the world that differed from the Eurocentric lessons propagated in media and schools. Above all, Sun Ra wanted to use music to heal, and he had a preacher-like conversion moment, part spiritual revelation, part self-described alien encounter. Sun Ra believed he came to the world to heal it. This quest to fill the knowledge gaps, to find the erased contributions of people of color, and ultimately to shatter the color class divides, resulted in an information trek that would last for much of his life. And this searching for more, this desire to know the answers that weren't yet readily available, was the impetus for his stretch in music. Nicole Mitchell, avant-garde jazz flutist and composer who met Sun Ra when she was 20, writes, "He had a very original concept that was way beyond his time. He was one of the first African Americans to start his own record company and was one of the first jazz artists to incorporate African percussion as well as improvising electronics into his music. He wanted to find the real power of music, which he believed could develop telepathy." Womack writes on this music, "With so many ideas to explore, space analogies were the ideal way to escape the parameters of music and humanity, and they freed him creatively to ponder the life questions he seemed so dedicated to answering and addressing through music. Hyperlinking his music to space travel created a prism of creativity in which Sun Ra could explore healing tones, new sounds, and push jazz beyond its bebop dimensions. Songs like Astro Black, Nubia, and Dance of the Cosmo Alien explored cosmic origins and sonically both abided and broke with the rules of modern jazz. Sun Ra was a showman, and the theatrical costumes combined with the music was a 1-2 punch that would come to define the assault on the senses that many musical artists in Afrofuturism would use as a model. Sometimes he drew his own album covers, and he was also a fervent poet. By the time he moved to New York in 1961, he sported his onstage garb daily, walking the streets of Harlem with his orchestra of Saturn-born ingenues. The band lived, ate, and created music together while immersing themselves in Sun Ra's philosophy and synergizing their unique approach. Anyone in conversation with him during rehearsal breaks and elsewhere was either held hostage or caught spellbound by his verbal debates and attempts to solve the mysteries of the world." In 1974, Sun Ra starred in the cult classic Space is the Place, an independent feature film directed by John Coney. An incredibly magical film that underscores the quagmires of self-determination, backed by Sun Ra's effervescent piano solos and rhythmic big band space music. Space is the Place is named after one of Ra's most popular songs, and the story follows his earthly return and attempt to leave the Earth and embark on a new life on a distant planet with different vibrations and under different stars. The film, easy to find on the internet, opens on a lush space. On this lush planet world, Sun Ra sits in a multi-hued garden in his new colony, wearing Egyptian Sphinx head garb, and states that time is officially over. He works on the other side of time now, he adds, and then concludes that he might bring the black populace to this world through isotope, teleportation, transmolecularization, or better still, teleport the whole planet here through music. Sun Ra then travels back in time to his early musical haunts and must contest with proverbial freedom gatekeepers, including a pimp named the Overseer, while embarking on his quest to transport the race to a far-off space colony with music. The film defies categorization, but Sun Ra's celebration of the unity of life is clear. "Yes, you're music too," he states. "We are all instruments. Everyone is supposed to be playing their part in the vast orchestra of the cosmos." Womack concludes, "Space is the place, creates a rich world to understand Sun Ra's sensory-altering sounds while conveying his purpose as a musician." While we don't have time to follow the whole history of Afrofuturist music from Sun Ra to the present, Janelle Monáe's recent work really stands out. For Monáe, too, uses traditional orchestra instruments, courtesy of the Wonderland Arc Orchestra, as well as kinetic computer-generated beats. Among her 10 droid commandments, these three stand out for our understanding of Afrofuturist aesthetics. Commandment 4, please be aware that the songs you will hear are electric. Be careful as you experience them and interact with electrical devices. Drink water or touch others. The Wonderland Arts Society will not be held responsible for melted telecommunications devices or injuries resulting from lockback, sweat tech, leave weave, pop arm, shock jaw, electrobutt, or any other maladies and malfunctions caused by the jam. And Commandment 6, abandon your expectations about art, race, gender, culture, and gravity. Or Commandment 9, by show's end, you must transform. This includes, but is not limited to, eye color, perspective, mood, or height. Janelle Monáe is quite simply today the most popular Afrofuturist musician, and more people are discovering her amazing work all the time. Here you see her bonding with the Black Panther cast while casting her in motion picture, Dirty Computer. While all her previous work is pretty amazing, her quite recent album film, Dirty Computer, which you can watch for free on YouTube, is quite simply a work of complete genius and a worthy successor within the tradition of Afrofuturist filmmaking that goes back to Sun Ra's Space is the Place. Maybe we can watch this one together during our film day next week. And don't forget to check out Janelle Monáe's Dirty Computer Q&A talk, which is really excellent and also easy to find on YouTube. For further study of Afrofuturist aesthetics and the Black Speculative Arts Movement today, or what scholars sometimes call Afrofuturism 2.0, I would definitely recommend this special issue of Topia on future movements, Black Lives, Black Politics, and Black Futures. Edited by Tobias C. Van Veen and Ronaldo Anderson. Their excellent article is a great overview of this enormous field as it stands today, and the volume as a whole is a great primer if you want to catch up on the Afrofuturist conferences, symposia, and festivals that have occurred over the last few years, including Astro Blackness, Afrofuturist UK, Afrofuturist Affair, and a number of events taking place under the banner of the Black Speculative Arts Movement, BSAM. As Anderson recounts, the origins of the Black Speculative Arts Movement lie in the planning and execution of the 2015 exhibition, Unveiling Visions, the Alchemy of the Black Imagination. For Anderson, we are entering into the phase of Afrofuturism 2.0, and this is the beginning of a move away from and an answer to the Eurocentric perspective of the 20th century's early formulation of Afrofuturism, and a further reclamation of the right of Black scholars, artists, and activists to tell their own stories, and also to critique the European-American digerati class in their narratives about cultural others. I hope you've enjoyed this overview, lecture, introduction to Africana aesthetics, Cornel West, hip-hop wars, and Afrofuturism. Thanks for listening, everyone, and we'll see you next time.